Hello everybody. Today we are going to talk about respiratory monitoring as part of anaesthesia. Now the routine respiratory monitoring includes first gas exchange, which can be done with pulse oximetry or end-tidal ETCO2, end-tidal carbon dioxide. Ventilatory parameters can be used can be monitored by using impedance monitors, inductive plethysmography. And regional tissue perfusion monitoring can be done with transcutaneous oximetry and capnometry, gastric tonometry and sublingual capnometry. Today we are going to mainly read about pulse oximetry. Now pulse oximetry, how does it work? The finger fits inside the monitor. It has a light emitting diode and it has a photo detector present in the lower surface. So the light emitted belongs to two different wavelengths, red and infrared, 660 nanometer red and 940 nanometer infrared wavelength. Now some light is absorbed by arterial blood, venous blood and some by the tissues. So the devices have been made in such a way that they capture the blood, the wavelength which is absorbed by the blood in arterial blood only. So it shows the oxygenated hemoglobin which is present. Now pulse oximetry is based on two important laws, Beer's law and Lambert's law. So according to Beer's law, the absorption depends on the concentration of molecule which is absorbing the wavelength, absorbing the light radiation. So as the concentration increases, so as the concentration of hemoglobin increases, oxyhemoglobin increases, the absorption of that particular wavelength also increases. According to Lambert's law, the distance which is traveled by the light as the distance increases, the amount of absorption also increases. So as you can see in this diagram, there is kind of a vasoconstriction. So the path followed is less. So there is less absorption. Here with vasodilation, the path increases and there is more absorption. HbO2, oxyhemoglobin, absorbs more infrared light than hemoglobin. We'll see this in the diagram also. So just remember, oxyhemoglobin absorbs more infrared light and hemoglobin absorbs more red light. So differential absorption is measured by the pulse oximeter and there's a microprocessor which calculates the amount of oxyhemoglobin and deoxyhemoglobin according to the absorption kinetics. And a ratio is created, and according to that, they'll display a value known as SpO2 value, saturation of oxygen value. Now, in this diagram, as you see, at 650 nanometer, the absorption, deoxyhemoglobin has higher absorbance, and at 950, oxyhemoglobin has higher absorbance. So these are detector levels, one light red light and one infrared light, and the ratio of these two, the absorption of these two, ratio of these two absorptions will be made, and according to that an SpO2 value will be calculated. So higher the ratio, higher would be the saturation in blood. As you can see here again, this is the red light and deoxyhemoglobin has higher absorption for it, and 950 nanometer oxyhemoglobin has higher absorbance for it. The ratio of absorbance are red by infrared is noted, and it is matched with the SpO2 levels stored in the microprocessor. So whichever value matches will show on the monitor. So now we come to the oxygen level in the tissues. So it has a pulsatile component, it has a non-pulsatile component. So the pulse oximetry assumes that all the blood in arteries is pulsatile. So only the pulsatile flow, the pulsatile part of the blood flow is taken as the arterial blood, and the concentration of oxygen carried by the hemoglobin in that part of the blood is only taken for calculation. Now, in systole, there is influx of oxygen-saturated blood, as we all know, inside the arteries, increased absorption of light in both the wavelengths. And in diastole, there is a slight change in the signal, but it's just 1 to 5% of the amplitude and does not make a very significant change in the SpO2 value. It measures around 100 times per second, and average of several seconds is displayed on the monitor. Now, you must have noticed when you put the SpO2 probe on the finger, it takes some time to display a value. So, at that time, it is actually calculating the average of those seconds. For each wavelength oximeter, it determines the AC and DC ratio. AC and DC, AC is pulsatile blood flow and DC is non-pulsatile blood flow. And accordingly, when SpO2 is 100%, it means the ratio of infrared by red is 0.43. And when it is 85, the ratio is 1. The confounders which can be present in pulse oximetry. So, calibration, monitors cannot, there's chance that is not calibrated. Perfusion, because the measurement site differs. In case of hypothermia, the distal tips of the fingers can be cold, and because of that, perfusion would decrease and the value measured by the pulse oximeter would change. In fingernails and nail polish, especially blue and black colored nail paint can interfere with pulse oximetry functioning. Ambient light, again, red light, ambient light, or blue ambient light can affect the reading. Bilirubin does not change the pulse oximetry reading unless it is very high, like more than 10. Anemia till a level of hemoglobin of 5 does not change the value of pulse oximetry. Lipid does not change much the pulse oximetry values. Motion artifacts are present. Intravascular dye, for example, indocyanin green, all these dyes can change the pulse oximetry value. These shows the values for carboxyhemoglobin. This lower curve is for carboxyhemoglobin, and this upper curve is for methemoglobin. Now, if you see this, the value for methemoglobin, absorbance value is same as reduced hemoglobin value. So when there is methemoglobin in blood, the saturation would be lower. It gets fixed at around 85%. Now, carboxyhemoglobin, if you see, it is the absorbance at 660 nanometer is similar to oxyhemoglobin. So carboxyhemoglobin, despite it being low, it will show a normal, false, normal SpO2 values. Again, this is showing the same thing. The methemoglobin value for absorption value is similar to the reduced hemoglobin, and thus a lower hemoglobin, thus a lower SpO2 value. And carboxyhemoglobin is same as oxyhemoglobin, so might show a normal SpO2 value. So in case of anemia, as I've told you, the saturation remains 100% till a hemoglobin of around 8, till a hemoglobin of around 5. So at even 8, it is showing a normal SpO2 of 100%. Now, coming to other modes of measuring the oxygen in blood, reflectance oximetry. So, in the upper part of the processor only, there are 3 light emitting diodes and 2 photodetectors. So, instead of the detector being in the lower part, the detector is present in the upper part of the monitor only. So, this gets reflected and is again measured. So, the only difference is that the detector which detects the absorption is present in the upper part and not the lower part, as in the conventional SpO2 probe. Now, another very important method to measure is co-oximetry. It's a device which uses spectrophotometry. Now, this can come as an important MCQ question. And it is used to measure the relative concentration of various forms of hemoglobin. Absorbance at multiple wavelengths of light instead of 2 wavelengths. So as we talked initially, there was a confusion when there was methemoglobin or carboxyhemoglobin inside the blood. So to tackle that problem, co-oximetry has been introduced. It is the gold standard to measure the blood hemoglobin concentration. It does not require a pulsatile flow. It measures either venous, arterial or capillary oxygenation depending on the mode you put it in. And it heats the blood to 37 degrees Celsius and is subjected to light of various lengths, and it assesses the absorption spectra according to that. Now the same mechanism, the same principle has been used in ABG machines. But still, co-oximetry can have false high values. For example, in ambient light, poor peripheral perfusion, poor probe contact, or in particular dyes, or when there is tricuspid regurgitation. The causes of low co-oximetry values and high pulse oximetry values can be carboxyhemoglobin, methemoglobin present, radio frequency interference, and leukocyte larceny. The oxygen consumption by cells in the collecting tube itself can cause an abnormal co-oximetry values. So further development was done, and a Masimo machine has been made, Masimo co-oximetry. So it measures total hemoglobin. It measures oxygen content separately, oxygen saturation, the carboxyhemoglobin component in the blood, the methemoglobin component. It also measures photoplethysmographic variability index, the PVI. Now this shows, this also denotes the fluid responsiveness of the patient. There is perfusion index. Perfusion index will show the pulsatile versus non-pulsatile flow. So it does, as we already discussed, in co-oximetry, it does not require the flow to be pulsatile only. For example, in patients with sepsis, where there can be low pulsatility in the blood. So in that cases, co-oximetry can be used. And of course, pulse rate is also measured. So that's it for pulse oximetry. Thank you.